Hey everybody, hot off a hard drive, Ham Radio Now is on the internet. Okay, this is episode 6, and we are going to talk to ARL's Chief Technical Officer, Brennon Price, N4QX, from their Washington office. Bet you didn't even know they had a Washington office. About the recently concluded WRC 12 in Geneva. Brennon brought back a new ham band at 472 kilohertz and fended off a few more threats to ham radio spectrum. So yay, Brennon. We'll find out all about that in a good long interview with him in just a moment. But let's see, what other business have I got here? Oh, the Blip TV thing. A couple of episodes back, Leo Laporte recommended blip.tv as a place where we could park Ham Radio Now episodes and get better distribution, often to iTunes and RSS feeds, things like that. Maybe even your ability to download them. I guess on iTunes, you'd be able to do that. Well, I'm working on it. I am actually uploading, established an account at blip.tv, Ham Radio Now. You can probably find some things there. I've been uploading the episodes, but I haven't fleshed out the website yet. They want things to look quite professional. They want me to do a lot of graphics and things like that. And I haven't had time, but I'll be working on it and just sprucing up the Ham Radio Now spot on blip.tv. So look for that coming up. If you're interested, they said that it was free, and it does have a free component to it. But if you want to put up something that is reasonably high definition, which for them is 720p, you got to pay a little bit. It's still pretty reasonable. It's $8 a month, and you can get paid by a whole year, $96 for the whole year. You get in 2 months free. And I'm still learning about how it all works and how it gets integrated to YouTube and iTunes and all that stuff. So not quite done there. Needs a little bit more work. Let's see. Oh yeah, one more thing. The money thing. So Arvin, Arvin, what's with the disguise? Oh, they did. Yeah, I think I saw that. They wanted it at the end. Yeah. Okay, we can try that. Pitch at the end. Talk to you about money later. Let's head up to Washington, D.C. Let me get your official identification. Who are you?
My name is Brennan Price, N4QX. I'm the Chief Technology Officer of the American Radio Relay League.
We don't have time to go through what Chief Technology Officer is, I don't think. But very briefly, what do you do?
My primary job is to advocate for international and domestic agencies for amateur radio, primarily relating to technical matters. Our staff just got back from WRC 12 about a month ago and had a wonderful, successful time busy time.
You see, I was thinking Chief Technology Officer, you decide how wide a sideband signal can be. Not so much.
Those questions are generally pretty much settled. It's merely a matter of interpreting.
There'll be stuff in the future that's not very much settled.
That's true.
So you do some technology, especially the international stuff.
I also have the responsibility to advise our board of directors and our CEO on the incorporation of new technologies into the amateur service and the amateur satellite service. So there are some things which aren't settled, which we try to figure out how to accommodate. And the more we can accommodate, the healthier the amateur service is, as a general rule.
Okay. I'm trying to get my phone turned off. there were some things that weren't very settled that you just went through at the World Radio Conference 2012. But before we talk about that, we are in a lonely outpost of the American Radio Relay League.
Yes, this is our Fairfax, Virginia office. It's a suite that I describe as typical suburban, nondescript office. We are above a dentist's office to the side of a computer repair shop.
For the ARL members who worry that the league spends too much money, at least in terms of looking around at this office, I have to tell you, they're not spending too much money.
We don't have a lot of needs here. We have a need for a place to hold some meetings, get some work done when we're not at meetings ourselves. And this facility serves its purpose. And
who do you meet with? What kind of stuff do you do here?
We primarily meet with the FCC and the NTIA and the State Department in planning.
You get big, powerful people in here.
Well,
where are they?
not today, at any rate. But we meet with officials at the International Bureau of the FCC, the appropriate departments, the State Department and NTIA, in order to arrive at what the United States is going to say about amateur radio matters.
He's really trying to steer this conversation to business, Brennan. That's not how we do business here.
Well, I'm pleased to follow your lead.
We're not too far from Washington, D.C., the seat of our nation's power. I feel the pulse of power throbbing through the entire environment. It's just, we're so close. And you meet with all those big guys. So, okay, now we can go down to business, if you insist. What did you just get done doing?
Well, IRU volunteers and the staff of this office were engaged fully in WRC 12 on a variety of issues. Probably the one most familiar to your viewers be our efforts to obtain an allocation below the AM broadcast band at MF. It was a long and tortuous journey. It started out
as... Which I want to hear in glorious detail in a minute, but let's get the headlines first.
Well, the amateur service was allocated worldwide, a secondary allocation between 472 and 479 kilohertz.
Huge 7 kilohertz wide ham band.
On the other hand, even though it's only 7 kilohertz wide, that represents a measurable percentage of the spectrum below 479 kilohertz, and also
sort of the equivalent of 10 meters, practically, for that spectrum.
True, and
you probably can't get one antenna to tune up from one side of it to the other.
Indeed, and as a matter of fact, there are some, in order to accommodate incumbent operations, we did have to allow some fairly significant restrictions in terms of effective isotropic radiated power at that band.
And what will that be? How much?
It will be.
How many kilowatts can we operate on?
It's not kilowatts. It's an EIRP of 5 watts. However, given typical antenna efficiencies on that band in a typical sized lot, that's actually a fair amount of power. And I suspect amateurs will be able to use this in a fulfilling way in the future.
Okay. Now, it is allocated internationally, but you can't turn on your radio today and operate there because the FCC has got to do something about that.
That's correct. I anticipate that within a relatively short amount of time, there will be a filing seeking to establish this band domestically, as well as taking care of a few other housekeeping issues.
Now, does the FCC initiate that on their own, or does somebody have to ask them?
Someone will have to petition. And
who might that be?
I would be highly surprised if ARRL doesn't petition.
Yeah. Other people can, right?
Other people can, if they want to.
And what kind of things will be in there? What are we going to be asking for? Modes? Power level's been set.
We will probably... It's probably a little bit too early to tell if we will be asking for any particular mode restrictions. As a practical matter, a band of 7 kilohertz in width is going to have a fairly limited selection of modes in order to maximize the enjoyment that amateurs can utilize.
We're probably thinking CW and maybe a few of the narrower digital modes.
CW, some narrower digital modes, slow speed CW would probably, I imagine, will be very highly used and I imagine be very, what's what I'm trying to say? They would work.
Yeah. I don't anticipate ever seeing a 472 kilohertz band on my typical HF radio. This is a specialty.
We have had a number of experimenters under an ARL experimental license headed by the management of Fritz Robb, W1FR, who've been operating over the last several years trying to demonstrate that amateurs could operate at these frequencies given the restrictions that are inherent with limited lot sizes and so forth, and also trying to demonstrate that various frequencies would work. Quite honestly, we didn't set out to land at 472 to 479 kilohertz.
Where did we want to be?
A number of people wanted to be at 500 kilohertz.
Dead on 500?
Dead on and dead around 500.
Very legacy frequency.
Essentially for those reasons, as a manner to... This initiative was, at least in part, to memorialize the fact that this was an important frequency in the history of radio communication.
What was that history? Because not everybody's going to know.
500 kilohertz was the International Maritime Distress Calling Frequency, and was through WRC 2007. That designation was removed at WRC 2007.
So that means that... ships mm-hmm. basically had to have stations operating on 500 kilohertz, transmit and receive, mm-hmm. monitored, I don't know, maybe in the old days all the time probably, and now less so, probably some automation, right. on Morse code.
Yes.
International Morse code, I guess.
Yes.
And what happened to that?
Well, technology outstripped that particular purpose. So its utility for distress calling was somewhat antiquated given the advent of the Global Maritime Distress Safety System.
Which is a satellite system?
Satellite and terrestrial components, mostly satellite components, in order to ensure safety of ships at sea. So when that designation went away... It was actually the German administration that thought, maybe there's an opportunity for amateur radio to utilize some spectrum, which is lying fallow here.
So we are now sneaking into that how the sausage got made stuff. This
yes.
is cool.
Well, it turns out over the course of 4.5 years, maritime interests went, whoa, wait a minute.
Just because we're not using it now
might mean that...
We might go back to CW. We might even go back to Spark if we want to.
Well, they actually proposed to move to high-speed data over the bandwidth of a typical AM broadcast station, which is not unheard of in that particular...
That's like 6 to 9 kilohertz wide, I guess.
Right. And... While some people,
this was the flight of fancy of some engineer, right? I
mean, it was, yes, actually. But while we could,
and evidently not a ham.
No, but while it became very clear that if we were to maintain our focus on the discrete frequency of 500 kilohertz and immediately around there. We would probably lose the battle, even though, as of right now, from a current STIP spectrum advocacy standpoint...
It is so hard to fight legacy,
that's
to fight history.
Well, it's not just legacy, but what people wanted to do in the future, or at least what people say they want to do in the future.
Yeah.
So
I'll go back with my original statement. Isn't it great I can do that?
It is.
You can't. You're constrained. I can say almost anything I want, and then I'll come hire you as my lawyer.
Okay, well, that's fine. I am barred here in Virginia, so I can help you out.
Sue me in Virginia, because then Brennan can help me.
Or Connecticut.
So we're going to stay away from 500 kilohertz.
We decided to stay away from 500 kilohertz.
Does it make a big difference? Talking about percentage of the spectrum, and a few kilohertz either way...
Well,
can be significant.
It did, because we had to trade away a political problem at 500 kilohertz and take a technical problem at less than 480 kilohertz in order to solve the issue. Not so much here in the Western Hemisphere, but in Europe, particularly Eastern Europe and Asia, some portions of Asia, these segments are used for aeronautical non-directional beacons, essentially navigational tools.
Yeah. So I was going to ask, we are secondary.
We are secondary.
And who are the incumbents? Who are the primaries?
Well, primary occupants around the world are actually the Maritime Mobile Service. Those pesky guys. But the secondary users are now the Aeronautical Radio Navigation Service, which is actually the most widely implemented user in this.
Now, these are non-directional beacons.
Yes.
And I looked at the allocations here in the U.S., and they stop well short of 472. And
yes,
then there's a couple more above 475. They are, at least here, they are AM, modulated CW, mm-hmm. on channels that are surprisingly close together, just
yes.
a kilohertz to mm-hmm. 2 kilohertz apart, which is too narrow for AM in reality, but with their geographic separation pretty far apart.
And they aren't, even though they are important with modern airplane navigation systems, they are becoming less mission critical. I
want to say nobody uses them at all in the United States. Send me email, kn4aqarvn.tv.
In the United States, well, first of all of the beacons are well below 472. It's because the FAA has a philosophy that they don't like to use spectrum where they are secondary. They simply find it to be too risky.
So the aviation people were secondary to the maritime people.
That's true, and there's nothing that's preventing a ship out there right now from firing up on, say, 472 kilohertz and sending a distress message. Now,
okay.
I think that their odds of having somebody receive that distress message are enhanced exponentially by having hams there to listen.
I guess, yeah, that's a good point. I wasn't expecting you to go there. Interesting.
Yes.
So the non-directional beacons are on the air. They're all operating, whether anyone's listening to them or not, yielding that question, if a beacon falls in the forest, does anyone actually copy it? So, but the maritime service, now we're thinking worldwide here, you know, mm-hmm. that not everything is first world country with satellite technology and all the fancy stuff that we've got here. And in most of the European countries, the rest of the world, some places, maybe they're still depending on some of these things.
Yes, and particularly in the old Soviet bloc, China, these beacons are widely implemented and probably used to a greater degree than they are here in the United States.
Okay.
And they are used with caveats. The International Civil Aviation Organization does advise pilots, to the extent that I know, or at least to the extent that I've been told, that propagation at this frequency band, particularly nighttime propagation, is unpredictable, and you can't rely on a 100% interference-free signal. So there is an acknowledgement by ICAO that these systems may not be absolutely perfect. Nevertheless, there are a lot of people who find them useful, and we were charged by the agenda item to minimize interference and take into account the need to protect existing services. And it would certainly be a black eye to amateur radio if operation of this band were permitted at a crucial time, too close in frequency and too close in geography to an aeronautical NDB. The results could be very bad for us, and we can't let that happen. And
so the 472 to 479, how well does that stay away from that stuff worldwide?
It does a very good job in most instances. It was identified as a segment which had minimal impact to existing NDBs. Does not completely eliminate the overlap, but various administrations in implementing the actions of WRC 12 can take steps to minimize the impact on NDBs. And there is also a method of additional protection within what we agreed at WRC. There are two additional tiers below the 5-watt EIRP limit. Administrations by administration, I mean a country, can put its name on a list, and essentially amateurs within that country and within 800 kilometers of that country will then be limited to a maximum output of 1 watt EIRP, okay. Which is actually still a pretty fair amount of power given the typical antenna at this frequency range.
Within their country, of course, their right. own jurisdiction, they can say whatever they want, but they can spread it out by saying we choose to use this this waiver or this provision of the international agreement that we can cover up most of your country too.
That's true, and that doesn't, by and large, it doesn't affect any country in the Western Hemisphere. The exception is a portion of Alaska because the Russian Federation is on that list. So from
800 miles doesn't get very deep into Alaska.
800 kilometers, so it's better.
Even less. It gets to Sarah Palin's porch.
If
no
you are,
farther.
I actually did a check from Big Diomede Island and an 800 kilometer radius. And if you are in Nome or Barrow or Bethel, you're stuck with 1 watt. Aside from that, we should be okay, assuming the FCC acts favorably on the petition. We're somewhat optimistic on that front.
Do you remember what frequencies the experimenting systems were on?
They started out between 495 and 510 kilohertz when it became obvious that we were going to have to look in another direction. We commenced some experiments below 478.
Okay, and do you remember what the results were and what did they learn?
We had hours upon hours upon hours of successful communication and successful reception reports with zero complaints of interference.
What kind of distance were stations able to operate? Is probably not worldwide.
Well, the terms of the FCC experimental license were such that international communications were not permitted.
They could still hear us.
Yeah, they could still hear us, and we did get some transatlantic reception reports, actually. But we're talking what one would expect for this frequency range, reliable ground wave propagation. Over the span of anywhere from a number of miles to hundreds of thousands of miles.
Nighttime propagation.
Yes.
And were they running about the same power levels, these experimental stations? I seem to remember like a watt and a half.
Some of them were running power levels about the output that was permitted. A few very well-equipped stations had the capability of putting up very substantial antennas and exceeding 5 watts EIRP. But I don't think that will be typical for what most radio amateurs will be able to set up.
Yeah, nobody's running a half-wave dipole.
To my knowledge, nobody's running a half-wave dipole.
Because that would be miles long, or at least
let's see, the wavelength is about 630 meters, so it could be.
Okay, not miles long.
Yeah, it could be done.
Yeah. Ham Radio Now viewers know I am not an engineer.
Right.
Let me get out the handbook and figure out the calculations. We're going to start experimenting seriously with the available technology, or generating technology, once this has been approved by the FCC. And so the next step will be filing a petition, figuring out the technical details. And
that's correct.
I mean, you guys out there, you can file your own petitions if you can figure out the modes that you think you want. Does the ARRL carry any extra weight with the FCC? You met with these guys. I mean, do they say, Gary from North Carolina wants to run ESSB and use up the whole 7 kilohertz? And the ARRL says some CW and PSK31. Who are they going to listen to?
I think that in the last few years, you've seen the FCC be somewhat reluctant in most cases to specify who can use what modes where. I suspect that in this particular case, there might be a little bit more scrutiny simply because of the small amount of spectrum that's involved. I would note that we do also have some significant restrictions on the channels that are allocated toward at 60 meters right now. I don't expect that we'll have anything that is as stringent there, but you know, I know that there are people who are really into enhanced audio and AM, and I think that they do a wonderful job at advocating those interests and pushing the envelope there. I would suspect that for the pleasure of amateur radio at large, doing that for more than a couple of seconds at this particular frequency range probably wouldn't earn one a lot of friends.
Okay, so we haven't lost any members for the league who like ESSB. Good job, Brennan. Once again, I can say anything I want. I'll lose viewers. You know, I never started out with very many viewers, and I can afford to lose all I've got. Timetable. No one knows how fast the FCC is going to work.
Price's rule of FCC rulemaking is that you will know when the FCC will act on something, when it is acted on something, and not a second before.
Every bit as good as predicting the weather.
Precisely.
You know what it was like yesterday perfectly.
I anticipate that a petition will be filed imminently. How long it will take? It will take as long as it takes.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we need to go talk to Bill W3TN.
Cross.
Bill Cross, yeah.
Yeah.
Bill, you watching? Anyway, that's what's happening now. How did we get there?
Well, we got
how long,
there.
How long ago did this start?
We got there over a process of about 4.5 years. Actually, it started immediately at the end of the last WRC. Every WRC determines the agenda for the next conference. And that's when this item came on the agenda. And there were also a number of items that we had to pay attention to defensively.
I'm going to correct you. Okay. Every WRC starts by thinking about the agenda for the next one and saying something about it. But
right.
I heard you say that all that planning that goes into walking into the rooms out the window once you walk into the room. Am I correct?
Well, it is somewhat out the window when you walk into the room, with the exception, really, of the agenda.
Okay.
You don't have... It's frowned upon it's frowned upon to seek to do something that the previous WRC didn't say that was going.
Yeah, because if it were wide open, you'd never get anything done.
Right, and there have been conferences in the past that have been that wide open. It's my understanding that the entire spectrum was up for grabs at WRC 79, which was one of the big ones in the history of amateur radio.
That still hasn't ended yet, has it?
it did seem to go on forever, from what I've been told.
All right, so you started at the last WRC. Whose idea got tossed in?
Well, this particular idea for an MF allocation was actually initiated by the German administration. There were a number of other issues that we needed to pay attention to that were put on the agenda. There was a suggestion that allocation should be made for oceanographic radar at HF. Oceanographic radar is a wonderful application. I have worked with some people at NOAA to try to understand what it does, and it does some absolutely amazing things as far as ocean surface mapping and current mapping. And occasionally, during the previous existence of HF oceanographic radar, which is under experimental licensing, they would end up on an amateur band. And anyone who's ever heard an HF oceanographic radar knows that it's fundamentally incompatible with amateur operation.
Is it like a broad signal, just hash?
It is a broad signal. It's not so much hash as it is a rhythmic, constant, and quite loud ticking. And it's a rather curious application because it works best at HF and only utilizes ground wave that's reflected back off the surface. But you can't remove the sky wave from an HF signal. So
all we need to do is go talk to the guys who invented BPL because they know how to control where radio signals go.
Yeah, well, don't get me started on that one.
Yes. Do we have enough tape for that? I don't think so.
At WRC 12, a way to accommodate HF oceanographic radar was found, and the solution, fortunately, did not impact amateur radio, and it was a real concern to ARL going into this last cycle that we might have to play more defense than we ended up having to play.
So at the conference, did they get their piece of the pie?
They did get some pieces of the pie. As with most issues, as with our issue at MF, it wasn't exactly what they were looking for to begin with, but it's something that we can work with.
Do you remember where they ended up?
They ended up in various slices, sharing with the fixed and mobile services, all the way between around 4 megahertz on up to around 40 megahertz.
Okay, it's so not inside any ham
bands. Not inside any ham bands, and we were very relieved.
Thinking kind of generally about the HF spectrum, my thoughts about, and when I teach classes, I tell people that HF is becoming less and less important and became less and less important when satellites started giving reliable worldwide communication to anyone who could afford them. Whereas the HF was narrow, relatively narrow, unpredictable, not something that anybody who had a serious need to be able to communicate between point A and point B would be interested in. And the pressure should be going off of HF step by step by step. And the hams who really love HF would feel less pressure on our bands, evidently, at least in some cases. I'm wrong.
Well, I wouldn't say you're wrong because I think that most telecom applications would identify the sweet spot at around 400 megahertz upward to around 5 gigahertz. That certainly seems to be where the focus of the mobile telephone industry
is. Propagation is consistent. Broadband. Interference is controllable. The atmosphere is kind of out of the way.
Right.
So what's left that really loves HF besides us?
Yeah, nevertheless, there are, I think, among those who are still utilizing HF, we're seeing a renewed interest. The broadcasters are, of course, there. There are a number of public and private sector fixed and mobile applications there for military purposes and for other government purposes. And I think users of HF appreciate the fact that they don't have to rely on infrastructure in order to, or on intervening infrastructure, such as
which is exactly our case for HF for emergency communications.
Right. And that is certainly why HF appeals to amateur operators, and it's a legitimate reason why incumbent users should continue, and will argue that they should continue to have HF allocations. HF issues are also hard precisely because the interference is not as predictable. There's a statistical component to any interference analysis over a certain percentage of time for two stations at two locations operating on the same channel. There will be an interference issue, and for a certain percentage of time, there won't be one. The question is, how does one predict how there might be an interference issue, and how does one avoid it? So I think, while I don't think that there are a lot of commercial interests that are interested in HF to do new applications beyond HF oceanographic radar, I think you are going to find that the users of HF are going to continue to fight for their allocations. It's not just a matter of reallocating everything to amateurs.
And the incumbents, even if their use of it has dropped off to almost nothing, they'll still want to keep it in their back pocket.
That's true.
Until all the equipment that they've got has turned to dust and they've got no funds to rebuild it, and then 20 more years have gone by. And then maybe they'll say, yeah, I think we can let that go.
Or they might try to invent a new system to put there.
Oh, yeah. Always that new technology.
Exactly.
All right. So the defensive action was the oceanographic radar. And anything else?
Well, we also had an issue where the ITU was considering regulatory provisions for software-defined radio and cognitive radio systems. Yep. And they did what I suspected they would do and what is the most desirable outcome for amateur radio. They didn't implement anything, at least not on software-defined radio. They did have a resolution on cognitive radio systems that encouraged countries that are next to each other to coordinate their use.
We need to define some terms a little bit. People probably have a pretty good clue of software-defined radio.
Yes.
Which is a radio that is not locked in by its own hardware. It is more what mode and what frequencies is something that you can write and rewrite and just load into the radio, and it does something different. Cognitive radio, probably people don't know what that is.
The idea behind cognitive radio is that a transmitter will sense its environment, determine the station that it needs to contact, and then automatically select a transmitting frequency or mode in order to accomplish that purpose without, ideally, causing any interference. And while the idea is very wonderful, it's essentially machines figuring out how to do what people do already in the realms of frequency coordination and interference avoidance. And if this technology were to be enacted successfully across all services, I wouldn't need to work because computers could do it all.
We are not ready to trust the technology. Skynet is out there.
The technology does have some limits, and I think that's been acknowledged. Nevertheless, there was a real possibility that some regulations could be adopted which would inhibit the radio amateurs' opportunity to experiment with these technologies. And fortunately, those are absent from the final product of the conference.
You gave a nice talk to Tapper last September at their conference in Baltimore. That is on the ARVN.tv website, so look for the Tapper stuff. And you were talking about what was coming up at the WRC, primarily with the focus on software-defined radio and cognitive radio. So it's still interesting stuff to go look at if anybody wants to go check that out. So you can see Brennan's about a 45-minute talk and be easy to find at ARVN.tv. So they left that alone.
They did.
How does that come about? What kind of stick do you walk in there threatening people with to keep them from doing that?
Well,
or is it all pure logic?
It's partly logic, partly carrying a stick. Although on the SDR and CRS,
you have no stick.
We're
hams. We have no stick.
Oh.
Brennan's got a stick. Don't tell him what it is.
I'm coy about my stick. But
and you walk softly.
With respect to software-defined radio, there wasn't a lot of convincing to do. I think once people began to study the issue and write the text that the conference would consider, they realized, okay, maybe this is not that as much of a problem as we thought it was. And that was easily enough taken care of.
Are the people that you're dealing with, how competent are they?
Extraordinarily.
And you're working with people at technical levels, mm-hmm. you're working with people at administrative levels, and you're probably working with people at high administrative levels. And I imagine the higher you go, the less technical competence you've got.
Well, there are a number of competencies that are useful in this type of work.
Be careful. Don't offend anyone, because we have to deal with these people again in, what, 4 years?
No. The combined technical competency and advocacy competency of the people who successfully do this work are quite impressive. And I would say across the spectrum, among the people who do this work, for the most part, even for people who don't have a traditional engineering education, they know which end of a microphone is which, and know how to use decibels in a calculation, and can make logical, persuasive arguments to the desired effect.
So when you're making your argument, and when they're making their counter-arguments, you get a lot of reasonable stuff. Do you get a lot of, or at least some, what orbit did you guys just depart from?
There's plenty of what orbit did you depart from to go around on a number of issues. The key is to realize early on what arguments work, what don't. Realize what arguments of the other party will work and won't work, and try to come to a solution that everybody can live with. I like to use the phrase, makes everybody equally unhappy.
Yeah, nobody gets everything they want, and almost everybody walks away with something, I guess.
Sometimes. That's how we try to operate.
That would be the ideal. So does it get emotional?
It can, and it does take some effort to maintain professionalism during some of the more outlandish arguments.
Set a stage for me here. How big are these meetings typically? How many people? Big conference rooms, huge chambers.
The way ITU conferences generally work is
we've got the United Nations, right, General Assembly room in our minds, but it's not going to be.
It's probably even larger than the UN General Assembly room. The last WRC had around 3,000 delegates.
And they all, at any point, are they all there in one room?
At some point, they are mostly crammed in one room or in the balconies of one room. There weren't enough seats behind the United States flag to accommodate every delegate from the United States. Most of the main plenary sessions I spent up in the balcony taking notes and trying to make sure that things stayed on track and emailing people if they went off track for whatever reason.
So how much time is that big meeting, and how much time are smaller sessions, and what are those smaller sessions like?
Most of the time is spent in smaller sessions, and it's somewhat like layers of an onion at most meetings, the work gets assigned to progressively smaller groups, then gets sent back up through the larger groups until it comes back to the big meeting. I actually had the opportunity to chair the sub-working group that was in charge of our agenda item at MF. I was, as a part of the United States delegation, I was chosen to shepherd the debate facilitates a better word, facilitate the debate toward a conclusion. And it was rather interesting because we had various countries and various regional groups proposing outcomes that were all over the map, from no change whatsoever to no change, but if we have to do something, let's do this, to 15 kilohertz from 472 to 487 with no power limitation. And trying to consolidate that wide variety of views was a challenge.
Does one individual, one country's delegation sort of become clearly the leader, where people say, that guy's smart, I like his idea?
Well, generally speaking, when you have a wide variety of proposals, as we did on our item, the consolidation toward one idea is not something you can really plan for. Everybody comes in sticking to their guns and saying, no, this is my way is the right way, and everybody else's way is the wrong way. And they tend to spend...
It's a radio club meeting.
Exactly. They tend to spend 3 or 4 or 5 days trying to advocate for their position. And then the Thursday of the first week, the Asian Pacific regional group came in to my meeting and said, well, okay, sooner or later we're going to have to move to consensus. We'll make the first step. Our proposal is an allocation of 15 kilohertz. We've changed it to up to. So that gave a little bit of room. I then chose the delegate for Australia and the spokesman for the Asian Pacific Telecommunity, Dale Hughes, to chair a drafting group to try to get everybody toward a consensus, or to get at least everybody who was proposing to make an allocation toward a consensus. And thanks to Dale's hard work and a little bit of work after his group adjourned, we came up with what came out of the conference. That was essentially settled in the second week. It took a little bit longer in order to get through the plenary meeting.
And so proposals are made, debated back and forth. Does everybody go back home, not home to their country, but home to their hotel rooms or whatever?
Home to their hotel rooms, huddle. Out to dinner, in meetings,
within their own hallway. Within their own country.
Not necessarily within their own country. I mean, everybody is there in Geneva for the duration.
But they've got to go decide, because there's more than one person there. They've got to go decide, okay, are we going to buy this? Are we going to, what's our counter proposal going
to
be?
Right, and they have to clear it with their own country if they're they're representing a country. They have to clear it with their own regional group. We're very fortunate to have an ARL staffer and my colleague here in this office, John Seiverling, WB3ERA, as a coordinator for the MF agenda item for CTEL, which is the regional telecommunications body for the Americas.
It's headquarters. That's beyond ham radio.
It's beyond everybody. Ham radio. It's wireline and wireless communications all across the region. Their headquarters is in the building of the OAS.
I guess one advantage hams have is that there are hams seated within the delegations and the interest groups spectrum-wide,
a number of them.
System-wide. I mean, there's hams every place. Any place there's technology. They can't act purely in their interest as hams, but in the back of their mind someplace, the ham radio stuff is going to be always there.
That's true, and there are a number of amateurs who have the opportunity to facilitate debate as well as I did. And it's an interesting dual responsibility. I could not have taken that particular job had John not been capable of picking up the manhole and making a very persuasive case for what amateur radio needed and what the region of the Americas wanted on this agenda item. When one takes the chair, one has to step back from the advocacy role and take a facilitating role, which meant going back and forth between people who did what I would like as ARL Chief Technology Officer to people who did not want to make an allocation.
Yeah, if you appear unfair, there'll be a rebellion and you'll be out.
Well, I think I did a pretty good job at that. I was approached at a restaurant the first Wednesday night by a delegate from Europe who said, "You don't think this MF allocation is a good idea, do you?" And I told him who I worked for, and he was surprised.
Wow, so he got you all wrong.
I suppose he did.
Yeah. Is there much cross-current stuff outside the meetings? Are there limitations as to how much you can talk to the other people? Here in our governments and stuff, a lot of restrictions on a board member or a county, whatever, they can't go talk to other people. The FCC can't talk to individuals without meeting and towing certain lines.
There is an expectation that delegates of a particular country will advocate for that country's position. So you will have hallway discussions wherein there will be an exchange of views between delegates, both government delegates and private sector delegates. And going over there, my colleague, John, had an obligation to advocate for the United States position, which was actually a two-band approach between 461 and 469 kilohertz and 471 through 478 kilohertz. 461 through 469 just didn't fly anywhere else in the world. That became evident real early on. So it then became incumbent upon John to go back to the United States decision makers, go back to CTEL and say, look, this isn't flying. Here are the reasons why. Maybe we need to reconsider. And after a while, that reconsideration is made, and you come up with a result that you come up with.
When you reach that final conclusion, are you surprised that, you know, some sausage actually got made?
I was somewhat pessimistic toward the end of the first week because it didn't appear that anyone was willing to move. I credit the fact that some movement was eventually made to our international representatives at IRU and also the representative of ICAO to the conference. ICAO came in to one of my sub-working group meetings and clarified its position on this agenda item, saying NDBs are used somewhat. They have utility now. They will probably continue to have utility for another couple decades or so. We would ask that they be protected, but we don't have a hard line against this agenda item. It was substantially more helpful than anything that a number of maritime interests came up with. The original maritime proposal was to establish a high-speed data communication system that occupied the entire spectrum between 415 and 526.5 kilohertz.
And evidently they got shut down.
Well, they on that to that extent they did, but they did get what they wanted at the discrete frequency of 500 kilohertz.
Okay.
So they didn't lose either.
So it'll be something to. I was going to ask a long time ago when we were talking about that maritime stuff. The NDBs, the aircraft stuff, still all on the air. Is the any maritime signals out there at all, or are they relying entirely on we're going to put some new stuff in the spectrum?
There are some. It is largely legacy in nature. We've not
Somali pirates.
No, not so much that. Essentially, people who like operating Morse, just like we would like operating Morse in these frequencies.
Old crusty maritime operators.
They're not necessarily old or crusty, but people who have an interest in that type of operation would like to continue to do so under the maritime.
I have an idea for
that.
Ham radio. Ham radio. Lots of CW on ham radio.
We thought it was a good mix. I'll just put it this way. During Fritz Robb's experimental operation, we did not find those periodic transmissions difficult to avoid.
So they weren't around a lot? Or they were out of range?
We didn't find them difficult to avoid.
I love this. So how long did this whole thing take? Was it a two-week conference, I think?
The conference was 4 weeks in total.
4 weeks.
You
spent a month in Geneva.
I spent 5.5 weeks in Geneva. I spent a week before that at the Radio Communication Assembly, which is the last meeting in the preparatory cycle before the WRC. It's one of those meetings where the best outcome that you can hope for is to be bored. I wasn't bored. There were some CRS issues that needed to be guided safely home. And there was also the leap second debate, which was...
The leap second debate.
Yes. It received some coverage in the popular press.
Yeah.
No.
We had to figure out one, right? Whether we were going to do that or
figure out whether the leap second was to be removed from the UTC timescale or not.
And it was not.
It was not. I was highly surprised that the ITU was the body that had responsibility for determining that, but apparently they are. And
It's because of WWV and that stuff.
It actually... has to do with the group that determines the international regulations for the standard time and frequency service.
They needed to put them somewhere, and this is where they put them.
Right. So.
Okay, so you got that figured out.
Yeah, so that actually got kicked down the road to the WRC 3 years from now. One of the items at WRC 15 is going to be to determine the future of the UTC timescale. But that is not the most exciting item on the agenda for WRC 15 from the amateur standpoint.
And what you were saying before was the next WRC's agenda gets set from this WRC. So how much time got spent hammering that out?
A remarkable amount. I would say that was one of the main focuses of the last 2 weeks of the conference, and it didn't really get settled until well into the last week.
Okay, so what's on the ham radio agenda?
Well, the perhaps the most exciting opportunity for ham radio at the next conference is a possible allocation on a secondary basis between 5250 and 5450 kilohertz.
60 meters.
60 meters. The resolution that describes the agenda item says that the spectrum need not necessarily be contiguous. It's not out of the question that a channelized approach may be what is decided. It doesn't specify what the ultimate bandwidth is. It simply says an appropriate amount of spectrum.
Lots of details to figure
right.
out.
We will need to
as usual. That's
right.
The way it works.
We'll need to take into account the need to protect services in the band, as well as, according to the text of the agenda item, the aeronautical radio navigation service just above that band. At 5450 and above. So we have a lot of issues that are on the plate. We're going to have a lot of studies to do. The issues surrounding 60 meters are significant. I'm hopeful for a positive outcome. If there is an outcome that is very broad and flexible internationally, it's not necessarily a guarantee that the full extent of that outcome will ultimately be implemented in the United States.
That little piece of spectrum, that seems to be particularly valuable.
Well,
a lot of services, a lot of people want to be there.
It is a portion. Every portion of HF has its own unique characteristics. It's the same reasons that amateurs find the spectrum worthwhile are the reasons why incumbent services find it worthwhile as well. And there's a segment of that band, 5250 to 5275, which was actually recently allocated on a secondary basis to HF oceanographic radars. So we're probably not going to aim for that spectrum. And we're probably going to resist efforts to encourage us to aim for that spectrum. It turns out that particular wavelength is ideal for certain types of measurement that oceanographers needed to do. And I'm glad that they were accommodated at some point. There was a scare for a while that they might be accommodated on top of the United States 60-meter channels, and that wouldn't be good for amateurs here in the United States and nearby, and for amateurs who have nearby allocations throughout the world.
Okay, so is there anything else that we're looking at?
Defensively, there are a number of issues that we are. I mentioned earlier the sweet spot of around 400 megahertz to 5 gigahertz.
Does this upcoming conference have particular focuses, or is it kind of broad?
Agenda item 1.1 is to identify more spectrum for the mobile service on a primary allocation, on a primary basis for IMT systems, which are essentially these things, and for mobile broadband applications. It's essentially an international component to the national broadband plan here in the United States. And that was a widespread or that was an issue that had widespread support for inclusion on the agenda. I know of no country that didn't want to visit this. The pressure on that spot is of concern to all incumbent users, amateurs and otherwise, trying to figure out how to fulfill that item while minimizing impact to other users, and from my standpoint, amateur radio, is going to be hard. Yep. We'll have to see how it goes, and I'm not sure that we'll know where it goes until the next conference draws to a close.
And we have vulnerable spectrum, and a lot of that are bands that are barely used by hams.
We do there, and there are actually some other issues that we need to address at the high microwaves. There is an initiative to be considered at the next conference to allocate 77.5 to 78 gigahertz, where we have a primary allocation, to radio location for vehicular
purposes.
I think
I've got that in one of my handy talkies.
Yeah.
And as much as we might not use those today, they could be very valuable pieces of spectrum, especially in our satellite service.
Yeah. They certainly could be, and it is a cause for concern, I think. I used to say long-term, but I'm not so sure that it's a long-term concern anymore.
Yeah. Well, the technology is working up there now.
Yes, the technology does work up there, and it would make for a stronger case, and I would certainly rest easier at night if we had more amateurs utilizing the broadest extent of their frequency privileges up at the microwaves and above. And of course, people are going to do what they want to do. I will gladly fight for any radio amateur's preferred use of the spectrum. I understand that some people have no desire to do anything other than operate CW on HF. And that's fine. I'm a HF CW operator myself. But when it comes to defending some of our frequencies closer to daylight, it's something that I think would behoove us to determine how can we best make use of what we have.
We have a lot of spectrum up in the higher regions that we don't use. And I mean, we have been given tons and tons of spectrum when people said right. It can't be used. No one knows how. And as we figure out how, as our technology reaches ever and ever higher, we lose some of that. And we keep little pieces, or sometimes we keep big pieces, and then those get whittled away. And that's just been going on forever.
Well, it's been going on for a long time, and I think what we need to consider is how we might use these slices of spectrum in the future, but also how much we really need.
Yeah, we want to keep something that's going to be reasonable right. for us to use. We don't expect to keep anywhere near all of it.
Our philosophy on some of the higher microwave bands for a long time now has been that we need to have some type of allocation, and the widths of such allocations and the primary or secondary status of such allocations are of lesser importance than the fact that we have the capability to expand there when we need to. I'm not saying that that's going to be the answer at 77.5 to 78 gigahertz, and I'm not saying that we're going to roll over and say, okay, if we can just have 50 megs out of that, you can have the rest. But what I am saying is that we're open to methods of creative solutions.
Before we wrap up, Dave Sumner would very much like me to have you point out how valuable the ARRL dues that we members have been paying for all these years are in allowing you and John, and who else went to Geneva with you?
Well, among the ARRL staff, Dave Sumner, John Seiverling, and I went to Geneva.
Yeah.
We had a number of representatives of member societies of the International Amateur Radio Union in attendance as well. All three IRU officers from there. No, it's not.
I'm sure you were staying in the best five-star hotels.
Oh, no. No, I was actually...
Motel 6.
I was actually staying...
We'll leave the light on for you.
I was staying in quite an interesting neighborhood next to the train station for the first 3 weeks that I was there, because that was the only place that I could get. I did move for the last 2.5 weeks, but I was by no means spending as much as I could have. Geneva is an expensive city. A Big Mac or 6 chicken McNuggets at a McDonald's with fries and a soft drink will cost at least 10 francs if you get a small soft drink, and upwards of 13 or 13 and a half.
I'm not international enough to have a clue what that really means.
Well, it used to be that a Swiss franc was worth substantially less than the United States dollar. Now it is worth substantially more than the United States dollar. And that's put some pressure on my budget line. But the upshot is...
Way more than you'd spend for chicken McNuggets here.
The staff in this office and the IARU volunteers as well are very mindful of the fact that we could not do this without the support of the members of our societies. And John and I could not do this, and Dave couldn't have done what he did without the support of 150 some odd thousand members of ARL opening up their pockets.
It is very, very disconnected from our day-to-day operating, though. How do we make the connection between a ham's ordinary day-to-day activity, which has got nothing to do with any of this, except it has everything to do with this? How do we make the connection between their day-to-day activity and what you've got to do over there that they just do not see?
No Spectrum user, whether the user is a broadcaster or a cellular telephone operator or a land mobile provider or WWV, is affected day to day by what goes on at the ITU. Nevertheless, the process that occurs over there is a very high stakes process, and it is not something which we can afford to take our eyes off of. Half of the battle is being there, participating in discussions, and earning respect. And that's what Mr. Seiverling and I are charged with in this office. And that's what we do. Mr. Seiverling does it extraordinarily well. I try my best to do it very well. I'll leave that judgment to others. But I do know that if we weren't there, the issues that we talked about would not have our perspective when they were decided by administrations meeting at conferences. And that is simply not a risk that we can take. Even at meetings where we hope nothing goes on, sometimes you need to be there to make absolutely sure that nothing goes on. And
You don't show up at is the one that is going to say, let's do something else with 40 meters. Let's put the broadcasters back across the whole thing.
And suggestions to that effect have been made at past conferences before my time, but it could happen again.
And speaking of which, it was one of those WRCs that cleared the 200 kilohertz of 40 meters that we now have clear.
That's true.
That was WRC 03,
and that was...
It was also one of those WR3s that put the broadcasters there in the first place back in the 30s.
That's true.
We didn't call them WRC back then.
It was a work back then, but or maybe it wasn't even a work back then. I'll have to check my history. But it is a process that requires a lot of attention, a lot of preparation, and we are deeply grateful to the membership of ARL and the membership of IRU societies around the world for helping us do this.
And what I'm thinking of right now, we have learned how some of the sausage is made. We cannot unlearn it as much as we want to.
Well,
what's your Excedrin budget?
I'm an Advil person myself, and the league pays me enough of a salary to take care of my personal expenses.
As much as you have presented a professional demeanor about all of this, some of it has got to drive you crazy.
Well, as I...
He can't say. Squirming now.
As I learned in law school, nothing worthwhile is easy. And there will always be advocates on the other side of the issue. And you simply have to work within the framework you have to try to move the opinion in your direction. And those who are on opposite sides of whatever issue we're advocating will do the same to me.
One more question has occurred to me, just one. Okay. I'm afraid it may open up a small can of worms.
Okay.
You don't get to propose whatever you personally, Brennan Price, wants to propose there. How does the U.S., the ARL delegation, and you're representing all hams, I'm not sure where all the input comes from. How do you guys decide what it is you're going to carry in, knowing you're not necessarily going to get it, but you got to start from somewhere?
Everything that happens within the WRC happens in microcosm, but to a certain degree as an expanded microcosm here in the United States. The United States went over with a position on RMF allocation, saying we would like two bands between 461 and 469, 471 to 478. That was its own piece of sausage.
That smells like, I smell compromise.
Yes, and that happened when we said we want 495 to 510, and the FCC International Bureau agreed with us. And the NTIA and certain maritime interests said no. And then some maritime interests said, on another agenda item, we want to establish a high-speed data communications network from 415 to 526.5 kilohertz that operates 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, 366 in leap years.
And one second
when you have a leap second that operates across that entire frequency. Okay, it took me about 2 minutes to demonstrate how that wouldn't be feasible on a single antenna. at which point
now we know why you're the chief technology officer.
Yeah, that wasn't hard to do, but it needed to be done. So far as what John and I do between WRCs, we attend domestic and regional preparatory meetings seeking to discuss these issues and arrive at consensus United States and regional positions on these
that
issues.
Is within the ham community and within the general RF community.
It is within the general RF community and within, at least within the United States.
How does the ARL decide what they want you to carry to that?
We have internal discussions. We don't leave our international colleagues out. There is a great deal of consultation that goes on with our IRU officers and volunteers. But no, we generally start with the high end of what we want, wait for somebody not to like it, and then engage in discussions until we come up with, to use your phrase, the piece of sausage that...
That's not my phrase.
Comes out. Well, you did refer to sausage making.
I introduced it to the discussion, but it's kind of generic. So I'm sure there's a committee within the ARL charged with hammering this out. You go to the board of directors...
I do report to the board of directors routinely on our efforts here in this office.
Yeah, but do they have to say board, at some
and
point?
And the board does have ultimate say-so over what we do. I report to Dave Sumner, and all Washington staff operates under the, particularly international staff, operates under the directive of our president and international affairs vice president. So but between meetings of the board, those are the two officers to whom we... the two volunteer officers, as well as Mr. Sumner.
Okay. You finally come with a position. Does that go to the board? And you all in favor?
The board does have the right to review any policy of the league. At least thus far in my tenure, they've read my reports and said, thank you for doing what you do.
Their Excedrin budget is not as big as yours.
Well, we'll see. That being said, any employee of ARL is very mindful of the fact that ultimately we do answer to a democratically elected board of directors. So board input and board okay in whatever form it's expressed, whether by by reading the report and deciding to focus on another issue, or whether by active intervention. That's something that we seek and we need and we value.
Yep. And for us members, all that is encompassed in that little email line that says the ARL Board of Directors minutes are available online for you to go read, which about one out of maybe 10,000 league members actually goes and reads. And of those, two or three of them just give you another nightmare.
Well,
I can't talk about this either.
Fortunately, it's been my experience in this position that membership is appreciative of our efforts, and that's okay, because no staffer of ARL is ever too busy to listen to what a member says, because at the end of the day, we are a membership service organization. Yeah. And if we don't serve members, we might not be able to make every member happy. When you have 150 some odd thousand, that's amateur radio operators, all of whom have individual operating interests that they hold very dear, that's probably an impossible task. But do we owe them an audience? Absolutely.
And you're there. I've been the president of a radio club several times. I know that in a radio club of 200-400 people, most of my time is used up by two people. You get some.
I am fortunate enough that I rarely have that issue.
Yeah, but you hear it happens. But for the folks that are going to make you reasonable arguments, that have a position that they want to get through, you're there. You'll listen.
Absolutely.
And I have a much greater appreciation of what the Chief Technology Officer does for the ARL. Thank you, Brennan.
Thank you, Gary. Appreciate you coming today.
So I'm all excited. Actually, I don't know if I'll ever operate 472 kilohertz, but it's there if I want to, or at least it will be once we get through the FCC rigmarole. And I know a lot of you will be excited about getting on down there. I can listen down there. I've listened to the non-directional beacons and other stuff, and it's going to be interesting. Coming up, hoping to be able to talk to Dan Henderson up at headquarters about two things that would be the 60-meter changes that have occurred, new frequency, new modes, new power, and we'll try to get to the bottom of all that and talk about some of the history of 60 meters and find out what's going on there and tell you what you need to do to be able to use those new frequencies. And the payroll tax bill thing, officially titled The Study on Emergency Communications by Amateur Radio and Impediments to Amateur Radio Communication. And this thing that they specifically put in impediments is private contract restrictions, otherwise known as CC&Rs, the codes, covenants, and restrictions. Those are the things that affect you if you have property in a neighborhood that has a neighborhood association or something written into your deed that tells you you can't put up antennas or that you need some kind of permission to be able to do it. And they're becoming much more popular. I remember when I was a kid, we could stick antennas up. We did. We ran around sticking antennas up on all of our roofs. And the only permission we had to get was from our parents. And we usually got that somewhat after the fact. And nobody cared. The neighbors didn't seem to care. And we had a great time. And now it's not like that anymore. So hopefully we'll find out about that from Dan Henderson. I may be able to record that interview in the next day or two. Probably won't have time to get it up on the web until sometime next week. So keep an eye out for that. In the meantime, thanks for watching. Oh, yeah, wait, the money thing. Yeah, Arvin, you still in disguise? Okay, you're not in disguise anymore. Yeah, well, very briefly, it's what we're hoping for, $10 per ham, 10, I should know this better, 10,000 hams, $10 a year to help fund ARVN, keep it on the air. Cliff and I drove up to Washington, D.C. Yesterday, Monday, and back all in one day, and then a couple of hours to interview Brennan. I've spent literally all day today editing that interview and getting it prepared. So a lot of time, a little bit of money involved in even just an episode like this. You can help keep things going with a contribution. We're asking $10 a year for 10,000 hams if we can get them. A lot of folks have donated more. It's not donated. A lot of folks have contributed more. I'm not a charity. It's a profit-making deal, or at least it's a business. A lot of people have contributed more, and some people less. The minimum on the website's $1.50. Whatever you want to put in, whatever it's worth to you, the $10 is just kind of a suggestion. So if you're willing to do that, thank you very much, and we'll see you on the next episode. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, for Ham Radio Now. Over and out.